pastoral letter, and that's all I'm going to do today, to read that pastoral letter to you. I don't usually have an audience like this who reads my pastoral letters. And therefore, I'm taking advantage of you, and it's a great privilege for me to read this to you. I am one of the few survivors of the Armenian Genocide, and I have devoted myself for many years in the hopeful endeavor to have this genocide recognized by the governments of the world. The Turkish government has been the consistent prevaricating voice of denial, and the U.S. government has abetted that denial in various ways. There are also so-called scholars, intelligent and venal, who have joined in this denial. Despite all this, the truth is finally breaking forth with clear promise that this crime against humanity will be acknowledged, recompensed, and will provide a moral force to bring this wicked world to its senses. As my father has stated in his memoirs, the Armenian is the prophecy of the world. Many books have been written about the Armenian Genocide. They have all been questioned by revisionists with some success. However, there are now two books which are of such starry strength as to be impregnable to any revisionist attack: The History of the Armenian Genocide and The German Responsibility to the Armenian Genocide by Dr. Vahakn N. Dadrian. I do not think these books can ever be surpassed in their scholarship, documentation, and absolute verification of events leading to the genocide. As I read them, noting that their documentation includes Turkish, German, and Austrian sources, I thought of Shakespeare's words in Hamlet, and this is Hamlet's words. He said, "For 'tis a sport to have the engineer hoist with his own petard. And it shall go hard, but I will delve 1 yard below their minds and blow them at the moon." It is with great anticipation that I look forward to revisionist and Turkish accounts belittling these documents. It will be a solemn joy to see them hang themselves. Dr. Dadrian is to the denial of the Armenian Genocide what the executioner Talleyrand was to Talon. He has traced the villain, cornered him, and finished him off. Any continuing life such denial may have will henceforth be the putrefaction of decay.
The program tonight have some other books that they have in the works. So at this time, it gives a great pleasure to introduce to you the head of Ukraine Books, Vahakn Dadrian.
Entire nation is filled with gratitude join my voice to that of our nation in saying a thousand thanks, Vahakn. Best wishes and heavenly blessings be with you. Signed, Father Sahab Janjanyan, Abbot of the Tibetan Congregation. Without further ado, it's my great pleasure to introduce to you Professor Vahakn Dadrian.
My lecture will have four principal parts, and they are, first of all, the Turco-German relationship in historical perspective, secondly, the significance and ramifications of World War I political and military Turco-German alliance, third part will be the acts and the actors of German complicity, and finally, fourth part, the significance of the German complicity issue in terms of national and international law. My definition of genocide has four elements, one of which, I think the principal one, is that we cannot study genocide as a conflict if we do not understand the history of the conflict. In the Armenian case, as well as to some extent in the Jewish Holocaust case, there has always been a history of protracted conflict, a conflict that defies resolution to peaceful ways, and the protraction exasperates the parties, and therefore, in the case of the Armenians, in order to understand the Armenian genocide, we have to understand the protracted conflict between Turks and Armenians. And an element of that conflict in the present case is, in terms of German complicity, the history of Turco-German relationships. Up to the period of Bismarck, there was general indifference towards Turkey, and even Bismarck, in his famous speech, indicated that he was not very much interested in issues of the Orient, and he said that the bones of a dead Pomeranian soldier are more valuable than the entire issue of the Orient. And yet, Bismarck, before he was dismissed by the young Emperor William II, in 1892, went out of his way to discourage, 4 years after the Berlin Congress of 1878, at which time he was the presiding officer of the Congress, he told England that they should not take seriously the Armenian reform issue. It's a deadly and hopeless issue. The Turks should be left alone, etc., etc. And this pressure upon the great powers was a major factor that the British, in particular, relented in their pursuit of the fulfillment of the terms of the 61 article of the Berlin Treaty. So Bismarck, in a sense, inaugurated a policy of defense of Turkish interests and minimization and degradation of the problems involving Armenian reforms. But I think the turning point in Turco-German relationships coincides with the dismissal of Bismarck and William II assuming control of German foreign policy after 1890-91. Three major developments highlight this turn of events. Number one, I think the major one, in 1888, Sultan Abdul Hamid granted concessions to the Germans to start the so-called Baghdad Railway project. With this project, this was a major blow to the dominant economic powers in Turkey, namely France and Great Britain. And this inaugurates the ascendancy of Germany in Turkish economic and political affairs. As you know, in 1889, a year after this concession, the Emperor of Germany embarked upon a major trip to Turkey and then to Damascus, where he proclaimed that Germany is the friend of 300 million of Mohammedans, now as he declared himself a defender of Islam. Following this trip, actually, William II made three trips to Turkey. All three trips had tremendous ramifications for the fate of the Armenians. The first one was 1889, the second was on 1898, 2 years after the completion of the Abdülhamid era massacres, and then the third one at the height of the Armenian genocide in 1917. Throughout these contacts with the Turks, the emperor explicitly indicated that he was not interested in humanitarian issues, and that the British in particular were hypocrites when they constantly, and even the Russians, that they used the concept of humanitarian intervention. And even at one point, Bismarck scolded the Russian foreign minister, saying that, why are you bothering in a confidential document to speak of humanitarians? Because the Russians were saying that we are the protectors of the Christians of the Ottoman Empire. William II had another interesting aspect in terms of cementing Turco-German friendships, namely, and I learned this only recently, by obtaining a document which hitherto has been unknown, and that is the memoirs of his first private secretary, Tahsin Pasha. In his memoirs, Tahsin Pasha reveals something which I think is extremely significant in terms of the secret, covert aspects of international diplomacy. Tahsin reveals in his memoirs that Emperor William sent to Abdülhamid technicians and engineers to install in his palace a secret communication device whereby the emperor and Abdülhamid frequently would consult with each other, and that the key to this code was only in the possession of the Sultan, and that neither the Grand Vizier nor the foreign minister nor any minister of the Ottoman Empire had any knowledge of this secret mechanism. I think we cannot overestimate the importance of this fact, that this contraption of secret, covert communications can perhaps indicate the degree of secrecy in international diplomacy and how overt statements, public declarations, are suspect in many respects. A very significant feature of Turco-German relationships of this period is also the abundant evidence from German, Russian, and even Turkish sources that Abdülhamid, consistent with his practice of bribing every official high and low, overwhelmed the emperor with gifts of all types. The French ambassador writes in his memoirs that if you estimate the total cost of the gifts, it would amount to the budget of the German state. Brilliants, golds, all kinds of things. And so, Sultan actually overwhelmed the emperor, and his personal relationships should never be underestimated in studying European and international diplomacy. So, what happened then prior to the World War I was that German and British influence in the Ottoman Empire was in decline, and German influence was in ascendancy in three domains, primarily and almost entirely in the domain of economics, commerce, industry, and particularly military procurement, that became almost entirely a monopoly of the Germans. Crude industries became a major factor in determining Turkish armaments. And in consequence of this development, Turkey more or less became beholden to the Germans. So much so that prior to World War I, the warlord Enver twice was appointed military attaché in Berlin, during which time he cemented close, very close relationships with Emperor William. by a German secret agent indicates that even the Turkish authorities, including TAD, did not know that Enver made two secret trips immediately before World War I and during the genocide to Berlin without even informing his colleagues. The combination of all these developments was a very critical development for Turco-Armenian relationships, and that is the dispatching to Istanbul in September 1913, the so-called German military mission to Turkey. What was interesting about this German military mission to Turkey, apart from its domination of Turkish military planning during World War I, was that it was once more exclusively conceived, organized, and executed by Emperor William II. We have German documentary evidence indicating that he didn't even inform his foreign minister, his chancellor, and it was exclusively the doing of Emperor William. He went out of his way to ingratiate himself with the two young Turk imperialist leaders, and the first act of this negotiation was the formation and dispatching to Turkey of the German military mission to Turkey. To indicate to you the significance and the scope of this mission, let me tell you that from its modest beginning, at the height of the war, during the climax of the mass murder of the Armenian people, this mission was in charge of 800 German officers and 12,000 German soldiers. Let me now, after this brief and historical introduction, move now to the first act of German complicity, and that is the secret political and military alliance between Germany and Turkey on August 2nd, 1914. There are three significant features to this development. Number one, it was a secret treaty. Nobody knew about it, even many ministers of the Ottoman wartime cabinet. It was arranged between Enver, Talat, and Grand Vizier Said Halim Pasha, and the German authorities, Vandenheim, and the military authorities. In this treaty, I think you find the foundations of German complicity in the Armenian genocide. First of all, as you know, one of the most terrifying acts of the Armenian genocide was the emasculation of the Armenian population at the very beginning of the World War I, even before Turkey entered war in 3 months later. That is general mobilization. As a result of the general mobilization, all able-bodied Armenian men were removed from their domains, were segregated, and we all know what happened to them. And who organized this? It was part of general mobilization, which we now have even by the testimony of the famous Turkish historian, Yusuf Hikmet Bayur, the dean of Turkish historians. In his second volume, he reveals to us that the Turks were unable to master such a major initiative as general mobilization, and Prussian German staff officers from the German military mission to Turkey organized and executed the general mobilization. Number one. Number two, the general headquarters of the Ottoman armed forces had four compartments or departments. The department which dealt with the Armenian genocide was Department 2 in German Battalion Tsar. And what happened was that the Germans got control of this Department 2 through Colonel Tanaway, who, according to Turkish testimony, said that he was a very severe man. He controlled all his subordinates of Turkish nationality. He was a very strict man, and he organized Department 2. And who was in charge of the deportations and the massacres? According to von Lossow was the German military plenipotentiary in Istanbul, the capital of the Ottoman Empire. And in August 2nd, 1916, in a secret report to Berlin, for the first time, and this is the only document we have, he explained explicitly says that the deportations and massacres of the Armenian population was organized in Department 2 of General Headquarters. One of the other consequences of the German presence in the Ottoman Empire during the war was a clause in the contract that the German authorities signed with the Turkish government about the duties, responsibilities, and the rights of German military personnel in Turkey during the war. This clause in French says, control effective sur la conduite de l'armée. As I said, the Germans with their full control of the planning of the military operations and of the war in general. And the second clause stipulated that when a German military commander is in charge of German Turkish troops, his chief of staff has to be Turk. And if a Turk is a commander of Turkish troops, his chief of staff has to be German and vice versa. In other words, the Germans, and this is in the memoirs of İsmet İnönü, the second founder of the Turkish Republic, he says that the Germans had optimal, almost total control of the organization of the Turkish armed forces. And he, Kazım Karabekir, and two other generals throughout their memoirs complain how and where allowed this development, that foreign generals, German generals, had not only control of the structure and the operations of the Turkish army, but that they knew all the secrets of this army. So, now, when we consider all these developments in terms of the ramifications of the military and political alliance between Germany and Turkey, we have to recognize that, as in the case of the Holocaust, so in the case of the Armenians, the destruction of the Armenian population of the Ottoman Empire was justified along similar lines. Namely, the Armenians were declared an internal foe. When you are in war and you have an external enemy and the minority population within the country is defined and declared an internal foe and is identified with the external foe, the destruction of that minority becomes the primary target of warfare. Because we all know the supreme objective of all warfare is military victory. And if you define the population as part of an external enemy, an internal foe, its destruction becomes not only desirable, but a compelling necessity. This is the framework, I think, through which we can analyze and examine and analyze the complicity of the German authorities, in particular German military authorities, in assisting the Turks in the destruction of the Armenian population. To them, it was strictly a military operation, and it was subservient, subsidiary to the military objective of winning the war. Let me now explain to you the underlying reasons why the Germans decided to engage in a military alliance with Turkey. In particular, when you consider that all German generals that I know, including Ambassador Wangenheim, were very skeptical about the military value of the Turks. They deprecated it as the most inefficient, it has no structure, no organization, and they said it will be a burden for Germany to have a military alliance. But all of these people, including the German general, the chief of the German general staff, were overruled by no other person than Emperor William II. It was Emperor William's will. He finally sent a secret telegram to Ambassador Wangenheim saying, disregard all objections and immediately agree to the terms of the Turks to sign a military alliance. I think here enters into the picture the political issue, namely the centuries-old enmity between Turks and the Russians. It is my understanding and from my conclusion that the only reason why the Turks and the Germans contracted such an alliance was a common objective, namely the elimination of the Russian bear. The Turks hated the Russians. We all know Russia, Tsarist Russia, for centuries has been a nemesis to Turkish national interests. Turkey lost war after war against the Russians, lost territories in the Balkans, in the east. And yet, by sheer strange coincidence, because the Tsar of Russia and the German Emperor were cousins, they became hostile to each other too. The German, particularly the Emperor, hated the Russians, the Tsarist power, and so the Turks and the Germans combined for the explicit purpose of undermining and destroying the Russian power. Because in the contract signed between German military mission and then subsequently in the secret treaty of August 7, 1914, there was a clause, secret clause, which said that Germany will do everything in its power to allow, to permit the Turks to recover, in particular, the three provinces in East, which they had lost as a result of the 1877-1878 war, Kars, Ardahan, and Batum. The Turks were desperate to regain these three provinces, and the Germans committed themselves in writing to assist them to recover these provinces. And we all know that there were huge Armenian populations in these provinces, in particular in Kars and Ardahan. So, what happened now to exacerbate the Turkish hostility to the Armenians? Two events. I'm sorry, I have to explain this historical facts so we can understand in full measure how the treaty became a fact and how it became an instrument of destruction of the Armenians. As you know, in the first Balkan War of 1913, in the fall of 1913, Turkey, the powerful Turkish Ottoman army, for the first time, suffered a major military defeat at the hands of its former subject nations, the Greeks, the Bulgarians, and the Serbs. These three nations combined their military forces and inflicted a crushing defeat. And even today, among many Turkish intellectuals, they had not recovered yet from the shock. How these former subject nationalities who were treated with such contempt within 6 weeks wrested from the Ottoman Empire nearly all the provinces of the Balkan Peninsula, and the loss was tremendous. 70% of the Turkish population in the Balkans and 85% of the territories were lost. This was in the fall of 1913. This is the time that coincides with a major move by the leaders of the Armenian nation, starting with the Catholicos in Echmiadzin, Patriarch in Istanbul, and civilian authorities led by Mubarak Pasha. It was at this time that the exasperated Armenians, who for decades had been trying to induce the Turks to introduce reforms in the provinces, they decided that this was the time now, Turkey emaciated, weak, impotent, desperate, that this was the time to reactivate the Armenian reform issue. So the Catholicos sent Mubarak Pasha with a delegation to Europe, and they went from capital to capital pleading the Armenian cause, saying that when you settle the Balkan issue, please, please, for the final, for the last time, organize the reforms. And the Turks, particularly the Italians, were infuriated. We read now in the memoirs of Karat Pasha, and even in the statements made during the genocide by Turkish leaders, that it was at this moment that they decided that they had to make a final reckoning with the Armenians. As you know, the deputy Zorab and Vartyes were not arrested on April 24th. They were arrested only 5 weeks later. During this time, both tried to placate Karad, saying that the Armenians are not hostile to the people, etc., etc. And in particular, in the conversation with Zorab, Karad pulled a file, saying, "Zorab, my friend, did you not go to the Russian embassy on this and this day, at this and this time?" write circulating petitions to the embassies of the great powers that this is the time to introduce reforms in Turkey. In our weakest moment, you, a deputy of the Ottoman Empire, of the Ottoman Parliament, went to our enemies, tried to exploit our weaknesses. And the greatest henchman of the genocide, the governor of Bitlis, who was the brother-in-law of Talat, told during the horrible carnage of Bitlis to another colleague of his, saying that this is the time of reckoning. In Turkish, şimdi intikam zamanıdır. In other words, they have never forgotten that the Armenians, and Cemal Pasha in his memoirs says that he warned the Armenians. He says, let's solve our problem together. Do not go to foreign powers. This is a history of long history since Ottoman period that exasperated Armenians, not able to persuade the Turks that they should introduce reforms, always went to the great powers, and this has always sticking points between Armenian revolutions, particularly the Pashnak Party and the Young Turk Ihtiyarists. They could agree on everything except on this point. The Turks said, don't invite interference, foreign interference. We have to resolve this as a domestic internal issue, you and us, citizens of Turkey. In any event, during this time, when Turkey was sustained such major losses in territory and population, the Armenians activated the reform movement in all capitals of Europe. But worse than all this, that compounded the problem, the vulnerability of the Armenian population, was another development, which to me I think was decisive. As you know, I have a full chapter in my first book, The History of the Armenian Genocide, The Great Powers of the Armenian Question. In that chapter, I have explained what a little role Lobanov, the foreign minister of Russia, played in the continuation of the Armenian massacres through Abdul Hamid. I have evidence that he secretly encouraged Abdul Hamid to destroy the Armenian population for a number of reasons that are typical for that contemporary period. The Russians were afraid of Nihilists, they were afraid that if Sultan Hamid is overthrown, other dynastic emperors will suffer similar fate, so they were against revolutionists, so they encouraged. They wanted a weak Turkey, they wanted a weak Armenian population to pursue their goals of coming to the, all the way to the Mediterranean Sea. So, but in 1913, a major change took place in Russian policy. Izvotsky, the Russian ambassador in Paris, wrote a letter to Sazanov that Nubar Pasha came to him and that we should seriously reconsider a new policy towards Turkey and Armenia. And it was at this time that the Russians decided to abandon the old policy of Lobanov and actively promote Armenian reforms. This was such a crushing blow to the Turks that here, their nemesis, their arch-enemy, doggedly for 18 months pursued Armenian reforms from 1913 to February 8, 1914, and they succeeded in inducing the other powers to impel, if not compel, Turkey to sign a new Armenian Reform Act, February 8, 1914. And it is my judgment that it is at this time, after the signing of this new accord on Armenian reforms, that the Ihtiyarist leaders decided that at the first opportunity they will solve this issue by eliminating the Armenian population violently and through mass murders. So, what happened then is that the Russian threat became identified with an Armenian threat. There was a new reform act, Turkey had contractual obligations, two new foreign inspectors were to come to the six provinces and govern them. It was an incredible humiliation for the Italian leadership. And as I said, I repeat again, I believe firmly that this is the turning point where general vague ideas of eliminating the Armenians acquires a concrete form. That is, the next opportunity, we will be a crushing blow to the Armenians. So this is then the context in which we can understand and analyze why the Germans and Turks joined hands in terms of a military alliance that proved pivotal for the organization and execution of the Armenian Genocide. Let me now move to the third part. And you know what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to compress an entire book in a confines of a lecture. So unfortunately, I cannot go into too many details. I can only speak in terms of staging outline forms. But I think it will give you a general idea about the content of the book. Now, the third part is the acts and the agents, the actors of complicity. I think, as I said before, in the Treaty of August 2nd, 1914, there was a situation that when the commander is a Turk, his chief of staff has to be a German. And if a German is a commander, his chief of staff has to be a Turk. And it so happens, and this is an incredible event, that since Enver was de facto commander-in-chief of Ottoman armed forces, his chief of staff had to be a German. And this German was General Fritz Bronsack von Schellendorf, a Prussian officer, a member of the German military mission to Turkey, an Armenophobe of the extreme, and he cooperated with Enver in every conceivable way to make the genocide a formidable success. Let me give you some specifics. We have now evidence, direct and indirect, that Bronsack von Schellendorf actually was the initiator of the idea of massive deportations. Two members of the Ottoman cabinet, first Interior Minister and then Grand Vizier Talat Pasha, in his memoirs, twice, specifically cites the name of Bronsack von Schellendorf as being the man who, for the first time, asked Enver Pasha to convene a top secret meeting at the general headquarters, to which participants were Marshal von der Goltz, Bronsack von Schellendorf, Enver, and a number of other Turks. And according to Talat, it was at this point that Bronsack von Schellendorf said that it was a military necessity to remove the Armenian population from the six provinces of the East as a theater of military operation and that they should be deported. Now, this is Talat's statement. Then we have the statement of the Turkish military naval hero, Rauf Orbay. Rauf Orbay, likewise, in his memoirs, specifically cites that the idea of deportation was first suggested by the German authorities in the general Ottoman general headquarters, although he hasn't mentioned Fritz von Schellenberg, but he states that the Germans were the initiators. Of course, for a scholarship, memoirs cannot be accepted as foolproof or irrefutable evidence. They are always suspect. So therefore, I don't think if I had only this evidence, I would venture to say that this is a fact. But I think for historical scholarship, I think we are lucky that there is a document promoted by the Turkish historians, and it's in every Turkish documentary book, that on July 26, 1915, General Fritz von Schellendorf signed an order in which there are three elements bearing on the Armenian genocide. Number one, he says, the deportation of the Armenian people has been decided. Turkish Ermeni Ahali, Armenian people, decided mukarrerdir. Then, he says, so here there are two points. First, he confirms the deportation, agrees with it. Number two, he does not speak of Van with this. This is Armenian people. That is the comprehensive general character of the deportation. But most significantly, in the second part of the telegram, excuse me, there's this. He says that for security reasons, we have to take all severe measures, şedade in Turkish, to prevent disorders as far far as the Armenian labor battalions are concerned, Ameletabur. You know, when you study the massacres of the Abdulhamid era, you come frequently across this word, Shedide, again and again. In all orders, from the palace to the provinces, during the Abdulhamid era massacres, the word Shedide is used. In Turkish, this is a euphemism, meaning massacre, destroy, severity. Because the logical question is, as we know, why were they created labor battalions? Ameletabur, why? They were disarmed. By definition, labor battalions were disarmed people. What logic is there to suggest that you need security measures, severe security measures for security reasons? We all know, by German accounts, Austrian accounts, how these security measures against labor battalions culminated in their slaughter. Very few labor battalions survived the Armenian genocide. Now, from a legal point of view, I think an observation may be warranted here, because there are two points here. First of all, I think the importance of this cannot be underestimated. That this is a document, the German origin of which I have been unable to find, is part of my 18 trips to the German archives in Bonn. I have been unable to find the German origin, but I am entirely satisfied that even today, the Turks are pushing this document as a legitimate, authentic document. So therefore, I have no reason to doubt its accuracy or veracity. What is significant about this document is two points. Whether or not the German general Schellendorf can be accused of complicity. Two arguments may be advanced here, against this claim. Number one, deportations are not necessarily coterminous with massacres. They can say, and they are saying, that deportations are wartime necessity. It has taken place in every other country, so I'm not guilty of genocide. Secondly, did he know or did he not know at that time that issuing an order of deportation was tantamount to destruction of the deportees? Well, we have to play now with dates. The document bears the date July 26, 1915. I have dozens of documents from the German archives, from Ambassador van der Leyen, from consuls in the provinces, declaring to the German authorities that under the guise of deportation, the Armenian population is being destroyed, annihilated. Did Bronstadt von Schellendorf know about this? Because these reports were sent from the consulate to the German embassy. He was in the Ottoman military headquarters, general headquarters. Well, this space investigation, I discovered several documents in which it becomes evident that Ambassador van der Leyen almost routinely forwarded all these reports to the German officers in the Turkish general headquarters. Not only that, there is a document sent by Schöllner von Richter from Erzurum, the Vice Consul, the German Vice Consul of Erzurum. May 20, 1915, Schöllner von Richter informed Ambassador van der Leyen that in Erzurum, the plight of women, children, and old men is so terrible that he went there and he saw Armenian women and children throwing themselves at the feet of his horse, pleading, crying, screaming for help, and he couldn't resist in distributing the bread to these poor people. Well, Ambassador van der Leyen forwarded this report to General Bronstadt von Schellendorf. Bronstadt von Schellendorf not only read this report, on the margin he made the following quotation. Our consul in Erzurum, Schöllner von Richter, would do better if instead of sending this bread to Armenian deportees, he should provide this bread to the Turkish army, and he got a warning from the ambassador. This is General Rosa von Schellendorf. Repeatedly, he also ordered deportation of Greeks via that document too. So it develops that this man, you see, don't forget his title, Chief of Staff of Ottoman Turkish Armed Forces. He has authority, he has legitimacy, he has power. And at one point, throughout the war, he defended the Turks. A Turkish newspaper wrote a comment about a Turkish general, not a Turk. Rosa Konchenko wrote a letter of complaint to the Turkish newspaper saying that, how do you dare to impugn the reputation of Enver? This was the man. And after the war, not satisfied with the agony, the tragedy of the Armenian people, in which he had a major responsibility, in Deutsche Allgemeine Zeitung, twice, he continued to decry the Armenians. He compared the Armenians to the Jews. He said, like the Jews, they are a parasitic people, and they deserve the fate that befell them. This is what he wrote after the war, 1919-1920. I shall, in my last portion, describe the legal ramifications of this stance. But let me move now to the next man, who I think played an equally critical role. I don't know how much time I have, but you know, is there a limitation?
No.
The second man who was as critical as Ronsard von Schellendorf was Colonel Dr. Felix von Guse. He was the chief of staff of General Mahmoud Kamil Pasha, the commander of the Third Army, headquartered in Erzurum. What is the significance of this? As you know, the bulk of the Armenian population of Turkey was concentrated in the six provinces. Van, Bitlis, Harput, Diyarbakir, Sivas, and Erzurum. And General Mahmud Kamil Pasha, a fanatic Ittihadist, a close friend of the number one enemy of the Armenian people, Dr. Nazım, and a friend of Enver, became in February 1915 commander-in-chief of the Third Army of the Ottoman Armed Forces, headquartered in Erzurum. He had jurisdiction over the six provinces, and the Turks, for expedient reasons, added the province of Trabzon to his jurisdiction. So he had control over the Armenian population of seven provinces in the east. And in my first book, in my second book, and later books, I will constantly dwell on this. Mahmud Kamil Pasha was the arch-organizer of the destruction of the bulk of the Armenian population. And who was his chief of staff? Dr. Felix von Guse, colonel. Colonel von Guse, in his memoirs, says that it was a gift of destiny that I became a personal friend of Enver. Great man, yet we trusted each other, and I was a devoted servant of this great Turkish general. I won't go into details except to say that in all his writings, Felix von Guse branded the Armenians, particularly of one province, as traitors, and he said they deserve the fate that befell them. Like, and he was also a close friend of Rosa von Schellendorf. In fact, in his memoirs, he said General Rosa von Schellendorf, the chief of staff, German Ottoman headquarters, was his idol, his role model. That's the word he uses, role model. He derogates the Armenians, and he says that they are not trustworthy, they are this, they are that. What is important about this whole issue is that from other studies, I learned that the most devastating reports from the provinces to the Ottoman general headquarters came from the staff of the Third Army headquartered in Erzurum. Small incidents were inflated to describe them rebellion, large-scale revolt of the Armenian population. As you know, the Turks went out of their way to provoke the Armenian population in the provinces. Squads of special organization, Teşkilat Masa, would go to small villages, ask for women, young girls to rape, And some Armenians resisted, and in the process, 3 or 4 gendarmes were killed by Armenians. These events were deliberately magnified by General Mahmoud Kamil Pasha's staff, which was run by Felix von Guse. And one of the commanders, the 10th Army Command, headquarters in Shiraz, in his secret report said that I have evidence that Mahmoud Kamil Pasha was selected expressly for this purpose. He would go to the Turk Army headquarters, he would organize provocations against the Armenians so that some Armenians would resist. In the process, there would be some Turkish casualties, and this would be used as a basis to declare the Armenians a dangerous minority behind the front. Felix von Guse was responsible for all these reports. And when you read today, volume after volume, the Turkish propaganda machine publishing Turkish documents are all these kinds of reports. A civilian Turk, a gendarmerie commander describing how the Armenians killed these things, always portrayed this as organized, centrally organized, massive rebellion against the Armenians. In any event, Felix von Guse, like his role model, Rosa von Schellendorf, after the war, continued to decry, defend, derogate the Armenians as the people who deserved the destiny they suffered. The third man, as an actor in this conspiracy, is Colonel Feldman. Colonel Feldman was the chief of Department 1, that is operations, and he was a very close friend of Enver. We have evidence from many sources that Enver every day consulted Feldman about operations against the Armenians. He and Rosa von Schellendorf accompanied Enver Pasha for the great battle of Sarıkamış, at which time the Turkish Third Army suffered a crushing defeat at the hands of the Turks, where almost 90,000 Turks either froze to death or died in the battle. Rosa von Schellendorf, Enver, and Feldman were in Erzurum between December 1914, middle of January 1915. And here, again, Armenian volunteers are used as a scapegoat to describe the military defeat of the Turks. It is true that at the Sarıkamış railway station, a small contingent of Armenian volunteers played a major role, delayed the capture of the railway station by the Turks until Russian reinforcements came, and this was a turning point in the battle. So they came back, Enver, Rosa von Schellendorf saying that the Armenians were responsible. So there's a close correlation between Feldman, Rosa von Schellendorf, and Enver deciding the fate of the Armenians as a result of this major battle, loss of the battle, military defeat in Sarıkamış. Then we have a very significant case in the person of Colonel Dadrian. Colonel Dadrian was also in the German headquarters. He was in charge of the railway workers of the Baghdad Railway construction project. As you know, tens of thousands of Armenians, workers, engineers, traffic directors were employed by the Baghdad Railway because it was an expedient construction for the war. On November 3, 1915, Dadrian not only ordered the deportation of all these workers, but unlike Rosa von Schellendorf, whose signature is missing in all these Turkish documents, they only mention this is by Rosa von Schellendorf. In this document, we have the signature of Colonel Dadrian. He is ordering the deportation of the Armenians. Once more, the question arises, was he not aware that by signing this order, he was signing the death warrant of the, and in fact, the majority of his workers were destroyed, like the rest of the Armenian population. So I have to pass now, because there are more details about this. The other person, very significant, I think equal to Rosa von Schellendorf, was General von Sepp. In December 1917, Rosa von Schellendorf was replaced by General Sepp. General Sepp, in his memoirs, he became a very close friend of Enver, like his predecessor. He assisted the Turks in every way he could, and in his memoirs, referring to the Armenian deportations, he said, during the war, sentiments of Christianity must be suppressed. The necessities of war require that we cannot afford to be philanthropes and sentimental Christians. And in 1918, when he was asked by the German government to allow surviving Armenians to return to their locations, he officially forbade, he prevented the return of the Armenians because he said it was the will of anger. As you know, General Sekt, who then became the founder of the German Wehrmacht that initiated the war in World War II, was also a major role player in the escape from Istanbul at the end of World War I of the seven top Ittihadist leaders, Enver, Talat, Cemal, Dr. Behati, Shakir, Nazım, and Azmi, and the police chief, Bedri. He organized, it's fascinating how they organized the escape of the seven Ittihadist leaders. And not only that, when Enver escaped to Berlin, Sekt continued to assist him to go to Russia to flee with contraband planes, etc., etc. And I was, these people remained faithful to the Turks even after the genocide. Then, of course, the most notorious case where for the first time we have documentary evidence of active German participation in the destruction of the Armenian population of the city. And I'm referring to Urfa. As you know, in the months of September, October 1915, Urfa, realizing the fate that befell the rest of the Armenian population, organized local resistance. They collected as much weapons as they could through contraband military uniforms, etc. And for three and a half weeks, they warded off the attack of the regular Turkish army under Fahri Pasha, who was the assistant of Cemal Pasha. The Turks could not penetrate the defense lines of the Armenians. In the construction of the city, the Armenians' quarter of the city were such that they failed successful defense. So what happened? Fahri Pasha asked a German major, Major Volsky, as an expert in artillery fire. He was engaged by the Turks. He was a member of the German military mission to Turkey. He came and with his cannonade, expert cannonade, destroyed the entire Armenian population of Urfa. Heavy bombardment. And as far as I know, this is the only instance where a German officer actively participated in the destruction of the civilian population of an entire city. And in his memoirs, he too, he decries, he derogates, he disparages the Armenians as troublesome minority. That was none of these people ever, after the war, expressed regret, remorse, or compunction. The pattern of hostility and mostly continued even after the great crime. Finally, I'd like to make a reference to Lieutenant Commander of the Navy, Hans Sumann. Hans Sumann was the Navy attaché at the German embassy in Istanbul, and according to Morgenthau and many other sources, he was the most powerful German officer in Istanbul because of his close ties to Emperor William. Unlike other officers, he had direct access, circumventing the embassy, direct access to German general headquarters and even to the emperor. Hans Sumann, from childhood, was a friend of Enver. He was born in Turkey, and when Enver became military attaché in Berlin, they became friends, so much so that they began in German, you know, unlike English and Armenian, in German you have Dao and you have you. For intimate relations or intimate friendship, you use Dao. For formal ways to say you. Human and Enver say to each other Dao. They are so close friends. And Morgenthau calls him an arch scoundrel in the matter of Armenians. And we believe that he played a major role in persuading German authorities not to intervene in the destruction of the Armenian people. But he has a final saying himself. He says that however harsh the destruction of the Armenian population was a necessity. This is his words. Then you have two German admirals, von Usedom, who was in charge of coastal defense and, in the peninsula of Dardanelles, and who told Morgenthau that the Armenians were in the way. It was a military necessity to remove and eliminate them. I think the most incredible comment comes from Admiral Souchon. He was in charge of the naval armada consisting of the cruisers, heavy cruisers, Goeben and Breslau, which then became Yavuz in Turkish. And as you know, the Turks were forced to intervene in the war through the provocation of this German naval armada. They forced the Turks to cross the Dardanelles, went into the Black Sea, began bombarding Russian installations in a number of port cities, forcing Russia to leave the war against Turkey. The Germans were itching for a war, and the Turks gladly joined this adventure of provoking Russia to declare war against Turkey. Souchon repeatedly said that Armenians were terribly subversive people, and to the Turks, the destruction of the Armenian population was a matter of life and death struggle. Therefore, he said, the rest Armenians deserves to be eliminated from Turkey. These are, in outline form, the principal military actors. Of course, I didn't say much about von der Goltz, so I'd like to complete this part by making a few observations about von der Goltz. Because unlike other generals, von der Goltz had a specific attribute. He was, as soon as the Baghdad Railway concession was given to the Germans, Germany dispatched then Major Goltz to Turkey to reform the Turkish army. For 13 years, he served in Turkey under Abdülhamid in reorganizing the Turkish army, and in this period, he was instrumental in gaining huge concessions, huge contracts for the German armament industry, specifically Krupp. But in 1897, just like his master, William II, when the Abdülhamid massacres were a scream, a problem, an anguish for humanity, people were still describing the harrowing details of the butchery of 200,000 Armenians in the period of 1894-1896. William II sent Major Potret to Abdülhamid, congratulating him and expressing his friendship. European powers, as cynical as they were, France, Great Britain, couldn't believe that here, in the wake of this major mass murder, the German emperor congratulates the Sultan and sends his picture as a gift. So with Goltz, Major Goltz in 1897 laid the foundations, I think, for the conception of the Armenian Genocide. He advised the Turks in the following way. He said, you have no business in Turkey. Forget Europe. Your place is in Anatolia. This is your heartland of Turkism. Remove yourself from European, the peninsula on the Balkans. Consolidate yourself in Anatolia, and he said, so that you have continuity with your Islamic brothers in the Caucasus and beyond, as a bulwark against the Russians, you have to remove the Armenian population of the eastern provinces, settle them in Mesopotamia, and create a continuity between Turks of Turkey and Muslims of Azerbaijan and beyond. 1897, a major article, an ideological guidepost to the Turks Belmont to come to Turkey to assist in the operation, military operations. So von der Goltz, at this time, repeated his argument before he went to Turkey in a major speech in Berlin, February 1914, 4 months before the start of World War I, in a major inaugural speech before the German-Turkish Association of Berlin, which had 5,000 members, membership and was initiated by the German Foreign Ministry, before a huge audience of German diplomats from the Foreign Ministry, Turks, he declared the following. He said, for centuries, Russia is trying to come to the Mediterranean Sea. It has ambitions on Turkey. It will truncate Turkish territories, and the Armenians are a major instrument for this purpose. He said, it is in the interest of the highest Turkish national priorities that this Armenian population, 500,000 Armenians in the 6 provinces of eastern Turkey, be deported, relocated in Mesopotamia. An Armenian young theology student, Balakian, who then became Bishop Balakian, reported from German professor who was present in this lecture, gave a report to the Armenian Patriarchate about the secret gathering. So, when he came to Turkey in 1914, he repeated the argument that the Armenians in eastern provinces were a major military liability for the successful conduct of World War I. And in his memoirs, he laments the fate of the Armenians, and he does not hesitate to declare a major national tragedy, the fate of the Armenians, in which he played such an ignoble role. I think I have to cut short here because there are other actors, but I like to make a very brief reference to two diplomats, not military people, who were equally complicitous, and the arch one of this was, of course, German ambassador Wangenheim. Von Wangenheim, as early as April 1915, when for the first time the intellectuals on April 24 were arrested and dispatched, he gave advice to Berlin. And he said, the situation of the Armenians is hopeless. Therefore, it is in the highest German interest that we do not intervene. Higher German interests, higher German stakes are involved. Therefore, I advise you not to intervene. Hopeless in German, is a hopeless situation of the Armenians. And it is very significant that in this celebrated volume of Lepsius, this paragraph is deleted. The advice of Wangenheim to his government not to intervene in the operations against the Armenians. Many other similar paragraphs are deleted. In any event, Wangenheim, according to Morgenthau, was emphatic and categorical in not wanting to intervene in the drama of the Armenian genocide. He even went so far to tell Morgenthau that I will assist the Zionists, I will defend the Jews of the Ottoman Empire, but I shall do nothing for the Armenians, whom he called a vermin. He called the Armenians vermin, according to the memoirs of Morgenthau. And it is very significant the circumstances under which he died and under which another enemy of the Armenians, Prince Lobanov, the foreign minister of Tsarist Russia, died. Lobanov died when, after the raid of Bank Ottoman, there was a carnage in Istanbul. 8,000 Armenians were bludgeoned to death. When he got a telegram from the Russian ambassador about the details of the carnage, according to reports from NATO and other people, he suffered a heart attack and died in the train. Something similar happened to Ambassador Wangenheim. According to Morgenthau, Morgenthau was trying to dissuade him from his position, to prevail upon him to intervene. He said, we are not talking about Armenian rebels, Armenian military people. We are talking about old men, women, children, innocent seconds after his statement, he suffered a cerebral hemorrhage, and he was taken to his bed. He never recovered. He died, and he was buried in Islam. It's a very significant coincidence, I think, in the two cases. In any event, let me briefly say now two words about two additional factors. One, the fanaticism which the Germans embraced in Islam during World War I, and the role they played in the proclamation of holy war, jihad, which, according to the head of the German military mission, Marshal Lehmann von Sanders, he said it was used exclusively against the Armenians because Germans were Christians, Austrians were Christians, the Turks did. How can you declare war against Christians and then you are allies with Christian powers? So, and then many Mohammedan Pakistanis in the British army fought against the Turks, as savage against any Christian. So the jihad didn't serve any purpose, the purpose that was intended, but served against tremendous attacks and destructive actions against the Armenians within Turkey. I think the more sinister role in terms of embracing Mohammedan fanaticism was in the formation of the specialization. As you know, the main instrument of the destruction of the Armenian population in Turkey was the Teşkilat-ı Mahsusat, which consisted almost entirely of released criminals, felons, repeat criminals. And it is, I think, unprecedented in the annals of human history that to select these people for this criminal mission, the Turkish interdis power wielders formed special commissions consisting of three people in each prison. One member was representative of the war ministry, one member was representative of the justice ministry, which was in charge of prisons, but the other one was a medical officer. His mission was to select the most ferocious, fiendish-looking criminals, husky, cruel, and pitiless people. And the Turks, many documents persist in emphasizing this point, that these teams that had the mission of selecting fiendish people involved a medical person to judge how cruel, how savage a person can be potentially. So, space organization was a direct outgrowth of a German suggestion that their mission was to arouse inside Muslim populations in the Caucasus, in North Africa, and in particular in the Caucasus. And initially, the budget, the financing of the special organization was organized and executed by the German authorities, specifically by Captain Nadolny. Captain Nadolny, who later after the war became ambassador to Turkey, was in charge of this secret special organization in which the Germans played a major role. Their headquarters was Trabzon, and we know what happened in Trabzon, where the bulk of the Armenian population of the province of Trabzon, including the port cities Samsun, Rize, were mostly drowned in the high seas. I believe that the attitude of Kaiser Wilhelm II about Islam being the most effective weapon against Great Britain and against Russia was along these lines. Let me now, to conclude, move to my last part, just in brief, discuss the problem of legal liabilities about German complicity. You can consider the problem in terms of first responsibility and then liability. To what extent, if any, were the Germans responsible for the destruction of the Armenian population? There are two legal documents which serve the basis for consideration. One is the German military alliance of August 2nd, 1914. Through this alliance, the Germans assumed a major responsibility for military operations within and without Turkey. The controlled the Turkish military, but they had also the highest command in terms of chief of staff in two critical roles, general headquarters and in Erzurum, where the bulk of the Armenian population was in that province and in the adjoining provinces. When we consider Turkish municipal law, Turkish national laws, and the penal codes of Turkey, we know that in 1919, 1918, 1919, 1920, the Turkish military tribunal prosecuted Turkish, young Turkish military leaders and condemned them to death, including Enver and Cemal, two military officers. Enver was the commander-in-chief, and in the verdict, in the key indictment, as well as in the verdict, it is explicitly stated that the crimes these people committed were to they repeated the words crimes against humanity. You know, on May 26, 1915, the Allies, Great Britain, Russia, and France, made a public declaration saying that Turkey once more is embarking upon massacres against the Armenians, and after the war, all agents of the Turkish government and their subsidiaries will be held accountable for these crimes. They will be punished. The Turkish military tribunal embraced this idea that the crimes perpetrated against the Armenians were not only violations of Turkish penal law, they were crimes against humanity. Now, we know that according to the contract signed between the Turkish general military mission to Turkey and the Turkish government, all military officers of the general military mission were automatically also employees and agents of the Turkish government. When the Turkish military tribunal condemns to death the top military officers, their subsidiaries, like General Brosak von Schellendorf, Colonel Betrich, who were under the command of Enver, became automatically culpable on the same grounds. They were not declared culpable for an explicit reason. The contract between the German military mission and the Turkish government stipulated that when German officers employed by the Turkish government commit offenses, the jurisdiction belongs to the German authorities. This is the reason why the Turkish military tribunal could not extend the conviction to the Germans. But the principle is there, the evidence is there, that they, according to Turkish as well as German law, they were employees of the Turkish government. They received payment, monthly salaries from the Turkish government, for the contractual obligations. This, according to Turkish law. When you switch to international law, the problem becomes even more compelling, because in the two Hague Conventions, 1899, 1907, there are three stipulations indicating complicity and culpability. Number one, when any national or international law cannot cover certain instances of offense, of violation of law, or certain transgressions, and there are no explicit provisions in the law, the standard to be used to adjust these people are general rules of humanity, civilization, conscience, and morality. This is stated in two conventions, The Hague, 1899-1907. And the prominent authority of international law in the contemporary scene declared that in the Armenian case, these provisions apply. True, there were no laws in Turkish or international law that the massive deportation and destruction of civilian population of their own citizens is a crime. There is no such law. But using the alternatives, civilization, morality, conscience, and laws of humanity, the perpetrators are guilty. And this was declared in 1919 in the Paris Temporary Peace Conference, in which Third Commission, Sub-Commission, consisting of legal international experts, they declared that the barbarities committed against the Armenian population by the Turkish authorities are offenses against civilization, morality, and humanity. Therefore, the Turkish perpetrators are guilty of crimes. Then, there is the additional consideration, namely, when you are an agent of a foreign government and you commit an offense in terms of political and military obligations, the responsibility devolves not only upon you, but it extends upon the state of which you are a representative. The entire problem of reparation, acknowledgement of kin, in the case of the Germans against Jews, as outlined by Konrad Adenauer, was based upon this principle, that the crimes of functionaries of the state are not limited in terms of responsibility to the functionaries, but to the state of which they are representatives. General Bronsart von Schellendorf was a member of the German military mission to Turkey. He represented the German government, he represented the Kaiser, who formed, organized, and dispatched this mission to Turkey. So with Colonel Bettrich, two officers who signed deportation orders. Finally, a major point. There is an argument that deportations of civilian populations is a military necessity. By all considerations of law, including the two The Hague Conventions of 1899-1907, there is no provision which allows or justifies the massive deportation and the eventual destruction of civilian population. This principle was embraced in August in the Geneva Convention in 1949, where it was explicitly stated that civilian populations are to be left intact, irrespective, no deportations are permissible, irrespective of motive. So, in conclusion, by any consideration, on account of this massive participation of significant German functionaries representing simultaneously the German government and the Turkish government, the German government is accountable and responsible in terms of liabilities. And here we have the interesting side note that corroborates this entire premise I'm presenting to you. When German Foreign Minister von Jagow learned that Colonel Bettrich on October 3, 1915, dared not only to order the deportation of Baghdad Railway Construction Armenians, but also affixed his signature, he got very busy. First, he wrote a letter of reprimand to Colonel Bettrich. How do you dare, you representative of the German government, to order and sign the order deporting the Armenians? He asked his commander-in-chief to remove him from his office, to subject to court-martial, and the German legal counselor in the Foreign Office, Dr. Goeppert, I read this in Bonn, his private papers in the Bonn German Archives. Dr. Goeppert wrote the following when he learned that Bettrich had signed the deportation order. He said, "This will have grave consequences for our government because we will be held liable for all the damages ensuing from this order, knowing full well that the deportees, as in the case of the Armenian labor battalions, so in the case of Baghdad railway engineers, workers, administrators, they were mostly destroyed." So here we have a German document, a legal expert in the foreign ministry saying that if you disregard any other thing, just that signature by the head of the railroad service in the Ottoman German headquarters ordering deportation makes the German state responsible and therefore liable for the consequences of that order. In brief, my book convinced, having studied in Germany and familiar with German culture, that we, multitudes of German scholars, historians, artists, conscientious, decent people who will rebel against their government, saying that, yes, historical facts, historical truth warrants assuming some responsibility, that justice delayed is not necessarily justice denied, and may appeal to them. And I'm happy to tell you that in the last days of my European trip, about 3 weeks ago, in Berlin, in Frankfurt am Main, prominent German newspapers, Frankfurt Allgemeine Zeitung, for instance, it's the New York Times of Germany, requested from my publisher a review copy. They will review my book on German complicity in spite of tremendous pressure by political forces, saying that we have enough with the Jews, we don't want to start with the Armenians. And so then the editor of the largest Berlin newspaper asked me personally to write an article which he will publish word by word about the summary of my contention of German complicity. And reports are coming now that, and even in France, the publisher of my French edition of the first book, Edition Stock, sent me a fax saying that this book must be translated in French and which must be distributed in French academic circles. So the issue of German responsibility is likely to be a very acute problem for public consideration. And I hope that this will, if to some extent successful, will close all the avenues of escape for the Turkish government, past and present, who persist sometimes with turbulence to deny the great crime. Because if a political and military ally of Turkey in World War I publicly makes some acknowledgement of complicity, complicity presupposes a crime. If the crime is there and if your ally is concurring or conceding involvement, what is left for the Turks, official or unofficial, to continue or to persist in denial? Thank you.
Show of damages. That
I understood your question. The question is general. What do I think about prospects of reparation? I don't think much except to lay out the documents and then wait for reaction. I think Professor Roger Smith, in his foreword to my book, indicated that there is hope that decent, God-fearing Germans, when reading my book carefully, they recognize the extent of German involvement and then therefore could not afford to remain indifferent. Reparations are bound to surface as a critical element of atonement for the Germans. I think this is, if I may say so, this is also my ultimate objective, not only moral redress, but also to some extent reparations to. And I think that if I'm successful to some extent, this may enable me to induce the German government to dispatch or to dispense a considerable amount of money to the Armenian government, and I don't know about individual reparations, but I think there is some hope, because three German, prominent Germans read already my book, and they think that it's inescapable that reparation would be an issue, and I don't think I'm betraying the secret when I tell you that the government of the Republic of Armenia has already purchased 500 copies of this book for, I don't know what they are going to do, but I sense that there are some plans to approach the German government. I also would like to say that the book is a byproduct of a suggestion by the president of Armenia almost a year ago. I understand that he read my first book, where chapter 16 is a compressed, succinct abbreviation of this book. You know, it's 40 pages, and he asked me whether I would allow them to reprint that single chapter of 40 pages for their own use, and I said that I not only give you permission, but if you want to, I can expand, because I have much more documents that I didn't have to use, and they asked me to do so. So a 40-page chapter in my first book became a 300-plus-page book. So I think the Armenian government, if there is any hope of reparation, we have to leave this to the foreign representatives of the Armenian nation, that is the Armenian government. And I know that there will be tremendous pressures on the Turkish government, because this would be a tremendous blow to the Turks if any governmental agency in Germany makes even a mild acknowledgement of involvement or complicity. So it would be a very difficult problem. We have to wait and see what happens.
Dr.
Tantra
would have probably mentioned that the overnight wouldn't have happened, this genocide. Based on your thinking, do you, as a historian, I wanted to know a long time, reading a lot of books, but nobody mentions, in a way, that British policy since the Israeli were against the Russian thing, you know, penetration to Iraq, that they suffered a lot. But what happened when San Stefano conference would have been instead of Berlin conference? Do you think would be the same thing? Because the same British Navy wouldn't go climb Ararat, but what happened? They went back after the 1917 revolution. The same Nagorno-Karabakh situation existed. What I'm trying to say, it can't happen that Germany suddenly comes, you know, in 10 years or 15 years beside that. Britain played an important thing. To me, I don't know, as a historian, I would like to know you, unless you mentioned in your book.
Well, we are talking about German complicity. That's a separate topic. But Lord George, in his memoirs, has a two-page acknowledgement of guilt. He acknowledges that we were guilty for the tragedy of the Armenian people, because in Berlin, we forced the Russians to abandon Article 16 of San Stefano, and by inverting the numbers, created 61 in Berlin. And he said, we have to amend, we have to repair this damage. We are obligated to the Armenian people, because by forcing the Russian army to withdraw from the three provinces, and relying on the goodwill of the Armenians, we left to the Armenians to the merciless of the Turks.
If after the Balkan Wars, the Armenians had not provoked European intervention, do you think the genocide would not have occurred? And the second thing is kind of a suggestion and a question together is, rather than possible German reparations to Armenia, this happens relatively soon, instead of that, how about German and other international support for Artsakh independence?
That's a political decision. I don't know how I can answer that question. I'm still thinking about this. Had the Armenians not intervened in this critical moment of Turkish history, where they were lamenting their losses in the Balkans, and at that time, I have Turkish backmans, many Turks are saying, watch out, we are not to the end of the Turkish tragedy. We lost the Balkan Peninsula. It is most likely that we will be the same level in our eastern provinces. Because, as you know, the Balkan War was the result of another article of the Berlin Treaty, Article 23. Article 23 of the Berlin Treaty stipulated reforms in Macedonia. Like before, the Turks disregarded entirely Article 23. They engaged in two major massacres in Macedonia, and that catapulted that was the precipitating factor for the three Balkan nationalities to join against Turkey. So many Turks said, watch out, there's another reform issue brewing in Armenia. We may have major losses in eastern provinces likewise. We have to do something about it. And the famous speech or response of Abdulhamid to the German ambassador in 1895, he had a meeting with German Ambassador Radovitz, at which time Abdulhamid is reported to have declared the following, and this is in German archives. He said, we can afford to lose the Balkan Peninsula. The Balkan Peninsula are our arms and legs. A person without arms and legs can survive, can continue to live. But if we lose the eastern provinces of Armenia, we will be losing our digestive organs, and that is death for Turkey. And he said, I shall rather die than allow the implementation of Armenian reforms in the eastern provinces.
Now, the question. You said three questions, and we have three.
Professor Dadrian, congratulations on your excellent research you've done on this genocide. One question I had is, what role did the German Jews and the military have to do in the Armenian genocide? What role did they play? I understand there's been some written on this, and I'm wondering how that can be
researched that by. The question was, I always encounter these questions, what role did the Jews play in the Turkish military? In my book, I have an appendix in which I am analyzing the reasons why the Greeks and the Jews escaped massacre to the extent that the Armenians suffered. I have an extensive chapter on the way in which the Jews escaped, because Jamal Pasha, as you know, was intent on repeating what the Italians did to the Armenians in the Palestine, Jaffa area. And this is very interesting because the German, I didn't have time to explain to you the German alibis. Indeed today, the Germans try to justify their behaviors in the Armenian Jews, and mainly the main argument is that Armenians were subjects, citizens of Ottoman Turkey. Germany had no right to intervene in the internal affairs of Turkey since they were not citizens of Germany but Ottoman subjects. This is the main argument, and then of course there are other arguments. But significantly, when Jamal Pasha began to deport the Jews in Palestine and threatened almost extermination, Talat immediately intervened, issued orders to Jamal to cease and desist. What happened? Kaiser Wilhelm, German Foreign Ministry, Ambassador Wagner combined forces to prevail upon Talat to say that don't do it. So, where is the argument? In the Armenian case, the Germans said they are citizens of Turkey, we have no right. The Jews of Palestine, many of them were Russian subjects, but as many, if more, were Ottoman subjects that they were deported to. The double standard here, well, Talat finally made a confession why they could not afford to treat the Jews the way they treat the Armenians. He said, Germany was trying to win over the Jews of America. Ambassador Zimmermann, Deputy Foreign Minister, let Wangenheim know that America was neutral. There was a big debate in the United States which side to be on, to the British, the Allies, or the Germans and Austrians. And I understand that many Jews, German Jews in America, were opting for alliance with Germany. So there was an effort to win over what they considered the influential Jews in the United States to swing public opinion in the United States to media, etc. And then, therefore, they went out of their way to be protective of the Jews. And then, at the end of the war, Javi and Talat told the American ambassador that they can ill afford to alienate the Jews of the United States. They are too powerful. Turkey needs the help of the United States, and the Jews are a major factor in this. I have an entire chapter on this topic.